Commercial explosives are unique, essential, and useful tools in our modern society. To be effective, blasting professionals must have the types, sizes, lengths, and grades of commercial explosives they need, when and where they need them. To fill these needs, storage magazines for explosive materials are necessary. These magazines must be safe and secure in order to ensure public safety and to mitigate the potential for unauthorized access. This program is called Safe Storage of Explosive Materials and is designed for industry and government personnel who locate, use, and otherwise are responsible for compliance with regulations governing magazines for storing explosive materials. The program will review the various classifications of explosive materials, explain the fundamentals of how the table of distances is used in designing magazine sites, or alternatively, how Institute of Makers of Explosive Safety Analysis for Risk, or IME Safer, a quantitative risk analysis software tool, may be used for the same purpose. The program will also describe the five basic types of magazines, examine safety and security procedures, and describe emergency procedures in the event of a fire or theft. Explosive materials is a term which encompasses explosives, blasting agents, and detonators. Explosives are any chemical compound, mixture, or device, the primary purpose of which is to function by the extremely rapid release of gas and heat. Explosives may be high explosives, blasting agents, or low explosives. High explosives include dynamites, detonating cords, boosters, shaped charges, detonator-sensitive emulsions, and water gels. Blasting agents are explosive materials that are a mixture of fuels and oxidizers intended for blasting and not otherwise defined as an explosive. Ammonium nitrate fuel oil, known as ANFO, is a well-known blasting agent. A blasting agent must meet prescribed criteria for insensitivity to initiation. Finally, detonators are devices that typically contain an initiating or primary explosive and are used for initiating other detonator-sensitive explosive materials. The federal government's Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, known as the acronym ATF, has the primary responsibility for regulating commerce in explosives in the United States. The ATF classifications of high explosives, low explosives, and blasting agents are used to specify the type of magazine required for safe and legal storage of these materials. U.S. Department of Transportation, DOT, and its Pipeline and Hazardous Materials Safety Administration use a different set of terms designed for marking, labeling, and placarding explosives in transportation and commerce. This includes loading, movement, unloading, and storage incidental to movement. DOT has placed all hazardous materials into 9 hazard classes, with Class 1 reserved for explosives. There are 6 divisions in Class 1, as defined in the DOT regulations at 49 Code of Federal Regulations, CFR, Part 173.50. Division 1.1 is for explosives that have a mass exploding hazard that would affect the entire load instantaneously. ATF designates explosives in this case as high explosives. Division 1.2 is for explosives that have a projection hazard. ATF may designate explosives in this case as high explosives or low explosives. Division 1.3 consists of explosives that have a fire hazard of either a minor blast hazard or a minor projection hazard or both. ATF would generally designate explosives in this case as low explosives. Division 1.4 consists of explosives that present a minor explosion hazard with the effect largely confined to the package, usually a low explosive to ATF. Division 1.5 consists of very insensitive substances that have a mass explosion hazard. While these explosives have a mass explosion hazard, they're also so insensitive that there is very little probability of initiation or transition from burning to detonation under normal conditions of transport. ATF classifies these materials as blasting agents. Finally, Division 1.6 consists of extremely intensive articles that do not have a mass explosion hazard. It's important to stress that DOT transportation designations, especially divisions assigned to packaged explosives, do not always clearly align with ATF classifications, and ATF definitions should be referenced to ensure proper storage. A Federal Explosives User Permit, FEP, must be obtained from ATF before any person can lawfully order, receive, or transport explosive materials, or cause explosive materials to be transported. A Federal Explosives License, FEL, must be obtained from ATF by any person intending to engage in business as a dealer, importer, or manufacturer of explosive materials. The ATF-issued permit or license must be posted at each place of business. Persons seeking such permits or licenses should contact the local ATF office for more information. Persons intending to store explosive materials must also comply with all state or local requirements. Magazines used for the storage of explosive materials, even temporarily, must be properly located and designed to comply with applicable federal, state, and local laws and regulations. ATF must be notified prior to acquiring, constructing, moving to a new site, or making changes to the construction of an existing magazine. Included in the notification must be the type of explosive materials, magazine capacity, and the location of the site. Others to be notified include, but may not be limited to, the local law enforcement, fire department, and emergency planning committee. The American Table of Distances, or ATD, published by IME, is the reference for citing magazines used to store explosives materials. The ATD was developed from the historic study of a wide range of explosions. ATF adopted the ATD into the Federal Explosives Regulations in 27 CFR Part 555, Subpart K. Based on a specific quantity of explosive materials, ATD tables in Subpart K indicate the minimum distance in feet each magazine must be from various exposed sites, including inhabited buildings, public highways, low-volume roadways, passenger railways, or other magazines. The ATD only applies to the storage of explosives and does not apply to blasting operations. IME Safer is a quantitative risk analysis tool developed by the IME that can be used to determine the safe and compliant siting of magazines. IME Safer calculates the event probability based on the material and activity and the effect of an explosion on structures such as houses or other inhabited buildings or affected public. Currently, IME Safer can be used to support variance requests from the ATD under ATF regulations. This modern, scientifically based program takes into account new types of explosives being stored, the magazine design, and the affected building design. The Federal Explosives Regulations enforced by ATF define an inhabited building as one that is regularly occupied as a habitation for human beings, or any church, schoolhouse, railroad station, store, or other structure where people are accustomed to assemble. Buildings that are occupied in connection with the manufacture, transportation, storage, or use of explosive materials are not considered inhabited buildings and are not subject to compliance with the ATD. ATD differentiates between barricaded and unbarricaded explosives magazines. Barricading refers to the effective screening of the magazine by either a natural or an artificial barricade. Natural barricades may be hills or timber of sufficient density that the surrounding exposures cannot be seen from the magazine when the trees are bare of leaves. An artificial barricade is a mound or revetted wall of earth at a minimum thickness of 3 feet. The proper height of a barricade is determined by drawing a straight line from the top of the magazine wall to the eave line of any other magazine or building, or to a point 12 feet above the center of a passenger railway or public highway. The drawn line must pass through the barrier. A separate table provides separation distances for ammonium nitrate and blasting agents, known as acceptors, from high explosives or other blasting agents, known as donors. The high explosives or higher quantities of blasting agents are considered the donor for propagation, while the ammonium nitrate or lower quantities of blasting agents are considered the acceptors. The separation distances in the table are based on using effective barricading of the acceptor ammonium nitrate or blasting agents, ranging from 12 to 60 inches, depending on the quantity of the donor. If barricades are not used, then the distance given in the table must be increased by a minimum factor of 6. Since ammonium nitrate is classified as an oxidizer and not an explosive material, the table only recognizes a 50% net weight contribution when ammonium nitrate is less than the prescribed minimum separation distance, either barricaded or unbarricaded. An important issue is the separation of magazines within the same site. If magazines cannot be separated by the distance shown in Table 555.218, or when applicable 555.220, they must be considered as one magazine, and the total quantity of explosives stored in these magazines must be treated as if they are stored in a single or grouped magazine. This requirement is for determining the minimum distance to the nearest inhabited building, public highway, and passenger railway, as well as the separation distance to other magazines. These groups of magazines are sometimes referred to as clusters. ATF promulgates and enforces federal explosive regulations for magazine construction in 27 CFR Part 555, Subpart K. IME provides best practices in Safety Library Publication 1, Construction Guide for Storage Magazines, which may be downloaded at IME's website, www.ime.org. Type 1 or 2 magazines must be fire-resistant and bullet-resistant. A magazine is considered bullet-resistant if it can resist penetration of a bullet of 150-grain M2 ball ammunition, having a nominal muzzle velocity of 2,700 feet per second fired from a 30-caliber rifle from a distance of 100 feet perpendicular to a wall or door. The Federal Explosives Regulation in 27 CFR 555 Subpart K covers 5 different types of magazine construction and lists the classes of explosive materials that may be stored in each type. A Type 1 magazine is a permanent structure such as a building or tunnel which is bullet, fire, weather, and theft resistant. It can be used to store all types of explosive materials. The foundations must be constructed of concrete, concrete blocks, stone, and wood posts. Wall construction must be wood with a metal exterior, masonry, or fabricated metal and completely enclosed, except for vent openings. The ground must be graded so water will drain away from the magazines or other drainings must be provided. Walls must be constructed of a combination of steel, masonry, or other materials which are fire resistant and structurally sound. Any voids in concrete blocks must be filled with well-tamped sand or cement. The interior may be lined with lattice and the exterior painted a light color to reduce heating of the interior. If lattice work is not used, explosives may not be stacked directly against the wall. Interior lattice work prevents explosives from contacting walls and ensures adequate ventilation. The floor may be constructed of wood or other approved non-sparking materials. The roof must be constructed of structurally sound materials, no less than 26-gauge iron or aluminum, fastened to at least 7/8-inch sheathing. If firing from surrounding terrain makes it possible to shoot a bullet directly through the roof at such an angle that it could strike the explosive materials stored in the magazine, then the roof must be of bullet-resistant construction. One method is a sand tray lined with a layer of building paper, plastic or non-porous material, and filled with not less than 4 inches of coarse, dry sand, and located at the tops of inner walls covering the entire ceiling area, except that portion necessary for ventilation may be used. Additional bullet-resistant construction methods for walls, floors, roofs, and doors are specified in ATF Ruling 7618. Ventilation must be adequate and will differ depending on the climate. Vent openings must be screened to prevent the entrance of sparks or rodents and must be offset or shielded for bullet resistance purposes. Doors must fit tightly and be constructed of not less than a 1/4-inch plate steel and lined with at least 2 inches of hardwood or the other bullet resistant construction methods specified in ATF Ruling 7618. All hinges, hasps, and locking hardware must be secured and fastened by welding or by bolts, which cannot be removed when the door is locked. There must be 2 mortise locks or 2 padlocks with a minimum of 3/8-inch diameter case-hardened shackles having at least 5 tumblers fastened in separate hasps and staples. Padlocks must be protected by quarter-inch steel hoods to deter the insertion of bolt cutters or other prying or levering on the locks or hasps. Optionally, there may be a combination of mortise and hooded padlock, or a mortise lock that requires two keys to open, or a three-point lock which secures the door to the frame at three points. ATF allows the use of hidden shackle locks, commonly known as hockey pucks or puck locks, boron alloy shackles, and recessed padlocks to secure the explosives magazines. More detail about conditions allowing their use are contained in the ATF ruling 2011-3. A Type 2 magazine is a portable or mobile structure, such as a skid magazine, trailer, or semi-trailer. Type 2 magazines can be used to store any type of explosive materials. Type 2 magazines must be bullet-resistant, fire-resistant, weather-resistant, theft-resistant, and ventilated. Type 2 magazines must be constructed of at least quarter-inch steel and lined with at least 2-inch hardwood or other bullet-resistant construction methods as specified in ATF Ruling 7618. The lock configuration must be the same as a Type 1 magazine. Type 2 magazines must be supported on blocks or some other foundation so that the walls are not in contact with the ground. The ground around a Type 2 magazine must slope away for drainage or other adequate drainage must be provided. If the magazine is less than 1 cubic yard, it must be fastened to a fixed object to prevent theft. Vehicular magazines must be immobilized by removing the wheels or with a kingpin lock. A Type 3 magazine is a day box or other portable magazine for temporary storage, which can be used to store any type of explosive materials. Type 3 magazines must be theft, fire, and weather resistant, but do not have to be bullet resistant. Explosive materials must not be left unattended in a day box, and at the end of the day must be transferred to a Type 1, 2, 4, or 5 magazine, allowing for unattended storage. A Type 4 magazine may be a permanent structure like a building, portable such as a box, or mobile like a semi-trailer. Type 4 magazines may be used to store blasting agents, low explosives, and non-mass detonating detonators, classified by DOT as Division 1.4, and stored in original shipping containers. Type 4 magazines may not be used for storing high explosives. Type 4 magazines must be theft, fire, and weather resistant, but do not have to be bullet resistant. Construction may be of masonry, wood covered with metal, fabricated metal, or a combination of these materials. The ground around a Type 4 magazine must slope away for drainage or other adequate drainage must be provided. Permanent Type 4 magazines shall be constructed according to Type 1 magazine requirements with respect to foundations, floors, ventilation, and locking devices. A Type 5 magazine may be a building, dugout, bin, box, trailer, or semi-trailer or other mobile facility such as a tank, bulk truck, or bulk tank. Type 5 magazines may be used only for storing blasting agents and must be theft and water resistant, but do not have to be bullet resistant. Construction may be of masonry, wood covered with metal, fabricated metal, or a combination of these materials. The ground around a Type 5 magazine must slope away for drainage or other adequate drainage must be provided. On vehicular magazines such as semi-trailers, only one locking device is required, and locks do not require hoods. However, the IME recommends two locking devices. Bulk storage unit dischargers must be closed tightly enough to prevent leakage. Placards required by DOT for the transportation of blasting agents shall be displayed as required when blasting agents are stored in a mobile facility. When unattended, vehicular magazines must have the wheels removed or otherwise be effectively immobilized by kingpin locking devices or other methods approved by ATF. Permanent Type 5 magazines have additional requirements. Bulk delivery vehicles loaded with blasting agents may be used for temporary storage if the following criteria are met. 1. All doors of the vehicle are locked and the ignition key is removed and secured away from the truck. 2. When the site is not in operation, outer perimeter security is established. 3. Each potential access point to explosives on the vehicle shall be secured by at least one padlock. 4. Each vehicle shall be immobilized through the use of a steering wheel lock, lockable battery disconnect, or both. 5. All vehicles preloaded with blasting agents shall be parked in a company-designated area, not susceptible to fire propagation. For further clarification regarding storage on bulk delivery trucks, refer to ATF Ruling 2007-3. Under ATF Ruling 2010-7, loaded perforating guns may be stored outside of magazines. The ruling outlines the requirements for the approval, including a requirement that the local ATF office be notified in writing no less than 3 days prior to using the alternate perforating gun storage. Both ends of holotype carrier guns must have a closure device and exposed charges must be secured to prevent unauthorized removal. Tools used to disassemble loaded guns, such as impact wrenches, must be kept separate and secured. A daily transaction sheet must be maintained and must include information specified in the ruling. The local fire authority must be notified of the storage and inspections must be performed every 3 days. Outdoor storage of perforating guns requires a security fence with a locked gate at all entrance points, and distance requirements must be met. Indoor storage may not exceed 50 pounds of net explosives weight. Loaded perforating guns stored in buildings must lie flat on the floor or be stabilized in racks, and the building must be locked or attended at all times. When illumination is necessary inside a magazine, electric safety flashlights, chemical luminescence, i.e. glow sticks, or lanterns shall be used. If installed lighting is authorized, the lighting must meet the standards of National Electrical Code. It's important to note that these are standards against which magazines are measured for compliance with law. IME's Safety Library Publication 1, Construction Guide for Storage Magazines, also offers additional construction standards, which exceed the legal criteria. Magazines used for indoor storage must be constructed of metal-covered wood, fabricated metal, masonry, or a combination of materials in accordance with ATF regulations related to the type of explosives materials stored. An indoor Type II magazine must be bullet resistant unless the building in which it's stored meets ATF's bullet resistant standards, or the combination of the magazine and the building meet bullet resistant standards. No more than 50 pounds of net explosive weight may be placed in any one indoor magazine. If more than one magazine is located in a building, the total weight in all the magazines cannot exceed 50 pounds for the building. The magazine must be painted red and marked Explosives Keep Fire Away. It should be located on a building floor that has an exterior entrance or ramps leading to grade, and should be no more than 10 feet from such an entrance. The fire department should be notified of the magazine's position. Detonators must be stored separately from other explosive materials for both outdoor and indoor storage. Very limited exceptions exist for storage of detonators with certain delay devices, igniters, electrical squibs, etc. Detonators may be stored in a Type 1, Type 2, or Type 3 magazine, although unattended or overnight storage is not authorized in a Type 3 magazine. Detonators that will not mass detonate may also be stored in Type 4 magazines. Outdoor magazines may not exceed 20 million detonators, whereas indoor magazines are limited to 5,000 detonators. IME recommends in Safety Library Publication 27, Security in Manufacturing, Transportation, Storage, and Use of Commercial Explosives, that a key access system be developed that minimizes the number of individuals authorized access to the magazine. If any keys are lost, the locks should be replaced or rekeyed as soon as feasible. A register should be kept of key identification numbers, number of keys, the number of locks associated with that number, and their locations. Individuals should sign in and sign out for magazine keys. The keys should be in a locked box, and the key to that box should be maintained by the individual who maintains the register. A competent person must be in charge of a magazine operations and be responsible for enforcing all safety regulations. The magazine should be inspected daily if possible, but at a minimum, each magazine must be inspected at least once every 7 days to determine if there's been any unauthorized entry or removal of contents. It's a good idea to post storage practices inside the magazine, as well as magazine emergency response procedures. Personnel assigned to work at a magazine site should be mature and responsible and not addicted to alcohol. personnel must be ATF responsible persons or employee possessors. ATF statute prohibits convicted felons, fugitives from justice, persons addicted to drugs, and adjudicated mentally incompetent persons from having access to explosive materials. Personnel should receive training in ATF's Subpart K, Storage of the Federal Explosives Regulations, as well as applicable state and local regulations and industry best practices. They should also learn record keeping, storage requirements, and truck loading procedures. They must learn how to make repairs to a magazine and understand that any such repairs should be made only when the magazine is empty of explosive materials. It's very important to protect and safeguard the explosive materials from any accidental explosion and unauthorized use or access. Personnel must be able to recognize an emergency, security breach, or suspicious activity and know the actions to be taken. The interior of the magazine must be kept clean, dry, and well ventilated. Explosive materials should be stored in their original packaging, flat with top side up. Partially used packaging must be closed. Corresponding grades and brands should be stored together in such a manner that brand and grade marks are visible. Stock should be rotated so that the oldest materials are used first. When any explosive material has deteriorized, it is to be destroyed in accordance with the advice or instructions of the manufacturer. Packages must be handled carefully, and non-sparking tools must be used for opening packages. Packages must not be dropped, thrown, or slid along the floor. Packages of explosives must be stacked in a stable manner. Forklifts or other material handling equipment must be of a type that can be safely used in the work environment and must be inspected before each use. Material handling equipment must be used as prescribed by the manufacturer. Forks must be tilted towards the rear and maneuvers must be carried out slowly. If a load becomes unstable, the operator must stop and restack the load. Handling equipment must be stored outside the magazine and refueling accomplished in a non-hazardous area. Before a truck, other than a bulk mixed delivery truck, is loaded, the engine must be stopped, brakes set, and wheels chocked. The cargo area must be clean and dry without any inwardly projecting bolts or nails. If there is to be a mixed load, explosives must be separated from other hazardous materials or from incompatible explosives. In such cases, DOT segregation and compatibility charts must be referenced to ensure safe and compliant shipments. The load in the truck must be level and secured in a manner that ensures cargo won't shift during normal transport. The magazine containing explosives must be securely locked at all times, except for the purposes of movement in and out of explosive materials, for inspecting the interior of the magazine, for inventory of explosive materials, or for repairing the empty magazine itself. A daily summary of transactions for each magazine must be kept. The transaction summary should include date of transaction, manufacturer's name or brand name, total quantity received in and removed from each magazine during the day, and the total remaining on hand at the end of the day. Record keeping and inventory are important aspects of theft prevention and its early discovery. If a theft or loss is discovered, personnel must first take action to safeguard the explosive materials from further theft, and then protect any evidence that may be used to investigating law enforcement personnel.
Dave, we've got a problem.
Okay.
Missing some boosters. Checked it three times.
Checked it against our physical inventory?
Yes.
Did we check every magazine to make sure it wasn't misplaced?
It's not there.
Nothing still left on the trucks themselves?
Empty.
Okay.
As soon as possible, report the theft or loss to the ATF at 800-800-3855, a nationwide toll-free number. Federal law requires any person who has knowledge of a theft or loss to report it within 24 hours of discovery. The phone report must be confirmed by filing a Form 5400.5, Report of Theft or Loss Explosive Materials, with the ATF. It's highly recommended that a full inventory check be conducted once a theft or loss has been detected. Also, the theft or loss must be reported to local and state law enforcement. Failure to report a theft or loss can result in a substantial penalty and/or imprisonment. After filing a theft or loss report, personnel must adjust the daily summary of magazine transaction record to account for it to ensure the inventory is true and accurate. There are activities that can help prevent theft. Unused explosive materials must be returned to the magazine, documented, and secured. Personnel who work with explosives should observe unusual activity around magazines and job sites. Suspicious activity may include strangers appearing to be loitering, plant trucks being followed, inappropriate behavior or questions by would-be purchasers or others, and apparent unauthorized access attempts at magazines or other explosives facilities. Suspicious activity should be reported immediately to the site manager, local law enforcement, and the local ATF office. The 24-hour hotline for ATF is 800-800-3855. Where a potential crime has been committed, personnel must take measures to protect any evidence that may assist law enforcement. Normal access roads to explosive storage magazines should be posted with a sign which is weather-resistant with a reflective surface. Signs should be sighted so that a bullet passing directly through the sign will not strike the magazine. In addition, the perimeter of the magazine should be posted with "Explosives Keep Off" signs. The danger of fire can be lessened by keeping areas within 25 feet of the magazine clear of brush, dried grass, leaves, and similar combustibles. Volatile materials, lighters, matches, open flames, and other sources of ignition must be kept more than 50 feet from the magazine. If a vehicle in the area of a magazine catches fire, it should be removed from the area, but only if possible to do safely. If fire comes in contact with explosive materials, or if a fire breaks out in a magazine, no effort should be made to fight the fire. Magazine personnel should contact the fire department immediately and then meet responding firefighters to inform them of the types and quantities of materials stored in the magazine. All people in the surrounding area should be evacuated to a safe location, at least 1 mile from the magazine on fire. Then, the perimeter and all accesses should be secured to prevent unauthorized entrance. In the event of a wildfire, magazine personnel may assist firefighters in keeping the fire away from the magazine. Explosives are an important tool in modern society, and they must be available to blasters when they're needed and where they're needed. This requires that explosive materials be stored safely and securely. Industry personnel must be sure the magazines are located properly, constructed in accordance with all federal, state, and local regulations, and that only authorized types of explosive materials are stored in each magazine. Personnel working at magazines must keep the magazine secure, inventory the materials frequently, and know how to respond in the event of a loss, theft, fire, or other emergency. It is part of IME's mission to advise all persons who store explosives to do so in a manner that protects industry personnel and the public, and to secure explosives to prevent unauthorized access and theft of these materials. All of us in the explosives industry play a critical role in advancing explosives safety. We hope that this video has helped you to understand and will help you to implement mandatory regulatory requirements and explosives industry's best practices for the safe and secure storage of explosive materials.